Okay, happy Sunday, church. We have been doing this for almost 2 months. That is crazy to me. We started Easter Sunday, so this is technically 6 weeks of doing this, and then 2 weeks before that, so we've been doing this for 8 weeks. So, you know, maybe you're getting a little used to it. Maybe you're like me, and I'm just like, this is still chaos. But this week we are definitely doing something new still, so still changing everything. We will be doing communion. So this is your reminder. If you have not gotten, if you've not BYOC'd, brought your own communion to church, go find something. If you haven't done it now, open space is also a time. One of the great things about this is you can just turn off your computer video and I won't even know that you've gotten. So spoiler alerts. Okay, I think that is your basically one notice that you need to have. As always, you can donate online at our website. And then I haven't gotten much of an update on this yet. I'll have one by Tuesday, so I'll have one for you by the middle of the week about planting and stuff like that. So we've got a couple of trees that we are going to plant, as well as Karen's gotten like some apple trees and some plum trees, so super pumped about that. I think it's gonna be May 22nd, May 29th, but that's still TBD. So just so let you know, we will send out more information, of course, on that as soon as we get it. And then something I'm really, really excited about, Jordan Harris and I have been organizing the Boston Methodist Pride representation for the last 5 years, almost 6 years now. And sadly, but totally understandably, the Pride Parade has been canceled. Very understandable, because it's thousands and thousands of people. We don't want to do that. That is great in some ways, because that's like a super anxiety and producing time. It's kind of sad in other ways, because we don't get to go to a Pride Parade, which is always so much fun, with Methodists from around the New England area. So as soon as COVID hit, Jordan and I started talking about what we could do for Pride this year. And so we are actually, Connection, which is Jordan's church, St. Stephen's and Marblehead, which is where Ross Johnson is, and then Old West, are co-hosting a Sunday worship on June 14th. So that is Pride Sunday. So I'm super pumped about it. It'll be regular, like same setup that we've been doing. It'll be look very similar to an Old West service. We'll have communion and everything like that. But just so you know, we will probably have a lot more people with us. We've already started recruiting from other churches, and we've got 4 or 5 other Methodist churches from around the connection who are gonna be sending people to us. So anyways, I'm really excited about that. So just so you know, June 14th, service is gonna look a little different, but that's good, change is good. All right, I think that's it for announcements. LaDonna, I believe, is leading us in our call to worship. So, mute yourselves if you're not LaDonna, and then we'll get started.
As you walk with us, as we journey together, everlasting one, your word fills our hearts. As you speak with us, as your love is revealed, almighty God, your fire burns in our hearts. As we proclaim what we have seen and heard, may all people be drawn to you, the risen one.
Wonderful. Our first hymn is "This Is the Day," which is so great because it's nice outside and sunshiny, and I love it. Well, it's sunshiny here. If you're not in Boston, then I can't talk about your weather. I don't do that. But it's sunshiny outside of my windows, and so I love it. So, Olga, who is leading us in our first song? Oh, she's muted. So
I am.
Okay, great. Wonderful.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice Let us rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Oh my gosh, Lena, thank you so much. That was gorgeous.
Thank you.
What a perfect start to our worship. Next is our responsive reading. Did I actually ask someone to do this or not? It's totally okay if not. I can do it if, okay, it's me, a team. Or John, do you feel like leading a responsive reading? Yes, no? Free in Christ?
I think Elsa could do better.
Okay, she's voluntold, I guess.
Yeah. All you nations, bless our God.
Let the sound of the divine's praise be heard.
God preserved us among the living.
The Almighty didn't let our feet slip a bit.
But you, God, have tested us.
You've refined us like silver.
Trapped us in a net, laid burdens on our backs.
Let other people run right over our heads.
We've been through fire and water, but you brought us out to freedom. So I'll enter your house with entirely burned off. I'll keep the promises I made to you, the ones my lips uttered, the ones my mouth spoke when I was in deep trouble.
Come close and listen, all you who honor God.
I will tell you what God has done for me.
My mouth cried out to my God with praise on my tongue.
If I had cherished evil in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But God definitely listened. My Redeemer heard the sound of my prayer.
Bless God, our Sustainer didn't reject my prayer,
nor did the Creator withhold God's faithful love for me.
Thank you, Elsa and John. That was perfect. All right, scripture. I think Ben, you are up for this?
Acts 2. We sailed from Troas straight for Samothrace and came to Neapolis the following day. From there, we went to Philippi, a city of Macedonia's first district and a Roman colony. We stayed in that city for several days. On the Sabbath, we went outside to the city gate to the riverbank, where we thought there might be a place for prayer. We sat down and began to talk with the women who gathered. One of those women was Lydia, a Gentile God worshiper from the city of Thyatira, a dealer in purple cloth. She listened. The Lord enabled her to embrace Paul's message. Once she and her household were baptized, she urged, "Now that you have decided that I am a believer in the Lord, come and stay in my house." And she persuaded us.
That's actually it. Sorry, I didn't put a Okay, well, now we're all super aware of my editing fails, so I will stop sharing my obviously perfectly made PowerPoint. We are continuing our sermon series on Acts, journeying through it. This is the start of the church's journey, spreading from Jerusalem and Israel out into broader spaces, expanding the mission of the church. So it makes sense that it really is a journey, and we are just journeying through it together. So Paul, with some friends, Paul and Timothy, are finding, Paul is on the journey, is finding a place to pray as he's traveling, and he finds one, actually. And what he finds while he's there is a woman, Lydia. She is, we're told that she is a God worshiper, which we've been told a lot about God worshipers so far. We've encountered them time and time again as we continue through this journey. So just a reminder about what God worshipers are. And also a little bit more about Lydia. We are told that Lydia is from Thyatira, and she's a dealer in purple cloth. This is a note for us, just to know a little bit more about her. And specifically, Lydia is very, very wealthy. Thyatira is known for its dyeing of, not dyeing like murder, but dyeing as in coloring, and trade of purple cloth. And purple cloth is important because it is a rarity. It's a difficult color to produce. And so that means that it is becomes associated because of its rarity to produce and the difficulty in it, and then the cost making that prohibitive for a lot of people. That means that purple cloth became very quickly the color of royalty, which is actually still a tradition that we have passed down for like hundreds and almost thousands of years. But even into the Middle Ages, purple was associated, a color associated with royalty. So we know Lydia is a very, very rich woman. And we also know she has a second home. So she's got her coastal home in Philippi, as long as her other home in Thyatira. And Thyatira and Philippi are across a sea. So it's quite some distance to travel, but she's able to do that. So she has freedom of movement. She is clearly very wealthy. And she seems to be managing the business. We are told it's not her husband's, but it's her business. So Lydia is definitely a woman with some like unusual social status and class during that time. She's unusual because of her faith practices. She is a Gentile God worshiper, but she also has a level of economic independence that most women during that time would never have experienced. So all of these things are noteworthy for us to, understand about Lydia. She's also the head of her household, and thus is able to be the one that offers the invitation for Paul and those traveling with him to come and set up a base camp in Philippi. This will be their place of operations as they seek to spread the gospel there. So in a way, Lydia actually functions as a patron, offering patronage. She leverages her privilege, her level of economic status, to support and shelter Paul and Timothy. Generally in this time, men would have been construed or considered with more privilege. However, in this Philippian community, this is a brand new community for Paul and Timothy. They would be considered outsiders. Additionally, they're not landowners there. So for them, they need an invitation and a way to support themselves, and would not have had that without Lydia. So they're about to come and start teaching and preaching some actually really controversial stuff. And so they actually did need this invitation, this offer of hospitality and an offer in some ways of patronage that Lydia provides. It's important to note for me, at least, that Paul doesn't actually care where the support comes from. Paul, who preaches equality in the love and mercy of Christ, is actually practicing that in his ministry. Paul is a very controversial figure in the church, probably has the most words that we know of written down in the Gospels. Or in the New Testament, because the Gospels were written decades after Jesus' time. And so this could be the best firsthand accounts we have, or at least the most like timely in terms of like how quickly they were written. So Paul is controversial in that he has a huge amount of voice. And sometimes he's like not great about women. So this is really important that what we see here is Paul practicing the love and the mercy and the equality that he's actually preaching. It might be, we can talk more later at another time about like some of the inequality stuff that Paul does, but in this case, Paul is like, on brand and is actually, you know, walking the, you know, walking his talk. I think it's also important to note that this early church, the very beginnings of the church, was not actually gathering in the church. They were out on the move. They were in churches. They were in houses. They were on the road. They actually didn't have set aside buildings for them to worship in, which for me is very poignant for right now. This was a church that was meeting in homes. This church was a movement. It was not a location. They were meeting in homes and on the roads. These early apostles, and it wasn't just Paul and friends, but a cohort of these people working together. They were collaborating, sometimes going out in pairs to bring the good news, sometimes alone, sometimes in groups, being sent forth as needed. This was a very mobile church, nimble, versatile, a church on the go. And this isn't, they aren't going out just because it's Paul's mission, Paul's passion, or even the community of believers' mission. This is the divine's mission, and the church is just a partner in that. And I think it's really lovely that this isn't, this mission isn't always a straightforward one. It's got lots of twists and turns. When I think about expansion, it's not that this expands in these like concentric circles, but actually starts popping up in lots of different places as the Spirit moves and as the journey takes place. It could be that obviously the church is spreading in urban places because that's where people are gathered. But as we know from the Ethiopian eunuch very early on in this series, that the gospel is spreading by leaps and bounds in ways that probably Paul, Timothy, and Peter could never have imagined, all because this is not their mission. Again, it's God's mission. And so, again, think of it not as a straightforward mission, but twists and turns. And a lot of this is that a lot of their journey, a lot of the spread of the church is actually a journey of waiting. It's a lot of like hurry up and wait. So we know that Paul and Timothy are being sent forth and being sent forth to Philippi, but there is this journey in between Jerusalem and Philippi that they have to take. And they actually do that. They take care in the journey. They take care on those new, those small steps that seem like maybe they actually aren't accomplishing anything, but we know they are, which we see with Lydia. And I would think, at least right now, for me, sometimes it feels like we're not actually doing anything. We're not checking off all of the lists that we usually are checking off. Maybe you're not like me, but I love a list. And it might feel like if we're not doing anything, we might feel like we're failing in that. It might feel like we're not producing as much right now, at least producing quantifiable things. And so that sometimes I feel like feels like we're not producing or doing something. That feels like we are letting someone down. And sometimes it feels like we're letting ourselves down. So if we're not letting someone else down, we're letting ourselves down because we're not producing something quantifiable or realistic. The way that we were supposedly producing these things of worth pre-COVID. But I want us to consider what the early church and learn from the early church. The early church was okay with the waiting. They were okay with this in-between time, this time of uncertainty, this time of no checklist being accepted or like checks off, but this time of the in-between and the actually, maybe this was something quantifiable. Perhaps we are seeing growth. We just can't see it yet. We're not able to see it and look back. I am currently in the midst of reading a massive science fiction series called The Stormlight Archive. And I don't mean massive like in the number of books. There's only like three right now. but each one, I was actually telling Elsa about this a couple of days ago. Each one is about 1,200 pages. just like daunting, but I'm obsessed with it already. I've read three books. That's all three of them. Still waiting on the other two. But so I'm in the middle of reading these massive, massive books. And one of the parts of this book that's so important is the ideals. And the way that I would translate that for real world is core values. So one of the main core values of the Stormlight Archive is journey before destination. Paul and Timothy, I think, embody this value so well. And this is a value that we see in the early church: journey before destination. Even though it's not specified, we know that the goal, the mission, is the spread of the gospel. But the journey always has to come before, and even is more important than destination. So another way to think of this is, yes, Paul and Timothy are traveling to Philippi, but they do not think that any action in between, or any interaction between Jerusalem and Philippi, is unimportant. They actually are being intentional every step of the journey. They see someone along the side of the road. They are seeking a place of prayer. And rather than going to another place of that they're like, oh, I need a place alone, they're like, oh, maybe this is the place of prayer. Maybe we are invited to be in prayer with these women gathered on the side of the road. For them, that is an intentional step on the journey. And actually, it furthers their journey. Imagine if Paul and Timothy had overlooked Lydia. Their next step would have been completely different. They would have missed an opportunity, an invitation into the community of Philippi. And we would have missed perhaps some of the interactions that Paul develops with the Philippian community, which we see later in his letters to the Philippian community. This is not to say that Lydia was a means to an end, but rather that she was, that every individual, every encounter, every step along the journey matters. So there's a quote from the book that I really like, that all journeys will have pain and failure. But if we stop, the journey ends, and that the end of the journey becomes the destination. So to love the journey is to accept no such end, and to know that the most important step we can take is the next one. So as we enter into open space, I want us to think about the journey. I want us to think about how we're thinking about our journey, both personally, as an individual, both as a community, but then also what our faith journey looks like. Are we more worried about getting to the destination, or are we fully aware and appreciating the journey? Sometimes it's really difficult to be appreciating or understanding or growing from what we're going through when we're in the midst of that. I get that. I also know that this is not a, let me be clear, this is not a statement to be like, I'm so grateful for like this trial that I'm going through. No, if you're going through a trial, that's a trial and it's terrible. But the journey matters. How you go through the journey matters. Recently, I had a mentor tell me that everything's a learning experience. And I was like, yeah. And sometimes the learning experience is that this is terrible and I hate it, which maybe was not the most mature response, but I think it's worth accepting that actually the journey isn't just full of joys and success moments like Paul with Lydia, but Paul was imprisoned and that was part of his journey. It's not to lessen our lows or increase our highs, but how we go through the journey matters. Are we being intentional? Are we being peaceful, careful? And I mean careful, not just careful. And grace-filled, especially with, right now, ourselves. Sometimes the most harm we can do is to our own hearts and our own capacities. So are we allowing ourselves to fully experience the journey? Are we experiencing that grace? And are we allowing ourselves to receive that grace in turn? One of the hardest things for me is to accept things from other people, including compliments, but also support and grace and prayer and insight. That is my thing. But I have a lot more time as I'm writing sermons to think about that and meditate on it. So maybe you are looking for some support along your journey. Paul is probably the best known missionary of the Christian church. Paul had a journey of support. Everything Paul did was in connection, in collaboration with other people. I'm not sure if you've seen President Barack Obama's commencement speech, but he talks about three things that we can take away. And one is be fearless. Two is do the right thing. And three is build a community. And I think that if we think about that on our journey, that is the perfect addition to our journey. So as you enter into open space, I'll play some music. You're invited to write your prayer requests in the chat, but I want you to think about your journey. Where do you need support or patronage or prayer from other people? What does that building that community, accepting that community and loving that community look like for you? So, I think, as always, you're able to, put your prayer requests into the chat box. Elsa and, Yvonne will be, taking care of that. If you are also playing on your computer or texting at this time, this is the perfect time to like pull your phone out and scan this little QR code at the bottom. That will link you to all our social media and YouTube and a link to donate as well, which is super easy. So yes, I'm encouraging you to pull your phones out now and do that. And think about your journey. As we enter into open space, this will be a time for you to reflect. Welcome to Open Space Church.
Share.
Wonderful. Now is the time that we shift into a time of prayer. So I invite Yvonne and Elsa to unmute yourselves and to begin leading us in our time of prayer.
Thank you. Albuquerque, New Mexico, 5 injured.
Rockford, Illinois, 1 killed and 4 injured.
Garrison, Kentucky, 1 killed, 4 injured.
Memphis, Tennessee, 4 injured.
Montgomery, Alabama, 4 injured.
Baton Rouge, Louisiana, 5 injured. God, hear our prayer. I was just going to say there have also been murders in Boston, and those don't get reported to this database, so I lift those up too.
For Nelson's birthday, God,
hear our prayer.
For all who graduated virtually this weekend, God,
hear our prayer.
Prayers for those graduating into this new society, may they be fearless.
God, hear our prayer.
Asking God for strength and health on my present journey.
God, hear our prayer.
Prayers of compassion for who are lonely and do not have enough community. God,
hear our prayer.
For the happiness of children.
God, hear our prayer.
In this time when pastors are being assigned, pray for all new pastors who have to start dealing with the crisis in addition to learning to pastor their flocks.
God, hear our prayer. Thanks to everyone willingly wearing a mask, almost everyone.
God, hear our prayer.
Prayers for marginalized communities around the world impacted by the pandemic. In Kenya, police abuse of power is rampant. 57 people have died from police abuse enforcing lockdowns, while 50 people in total have died from the virus. God, hear our prayer.
I pray for strength and hope on the journey.
God, hear our prayer.
Thanks be to God for all the blessings we experience in the middle of the pandemic time. God, hear our prayer.
Bring an end to all systems of oppression and institutions of injustice. Teach us mercy and grace for ourselves and for each other.
God, hear our prayer.
That the people we need most will be placed on our paths and into our communities. God, hear our prayer.
So let us join together in prayer. God of the journey, guide on the journey, presence on the journey, we lift up these prayers and we pay attention and we gather strength and we recognize wisdom in the prayers themselves as they've been written. We pray that we are able to have a day today that we live fully and that we can do it again tomorrow, even with all the constraints that the pandemic is placing upon us. We are horrified by the death toll and the number of sick people in the United States. To contrast, 50 deaths in Kenya and thousands of deaths, almost 100,000 deaths in this country. We've got to learn how to do better as a country, as a society. We pray for our leaders. We give thanks for those who are giving us wise guidance. And we pray for those who are distracting and spreading conspiracy theories that something will wake them up to reality and that they can be compassionate towards one another and practice safe behavior. We lift up the children, especially all the children in the public school systems, and give thanks for the teachers and staff working not only to keep learning going on, but to take care the way they take care of kids every day. We know that there's so much more abuse going on. We can hear it over our back fence. We pray for parents and kids struggling to make life work in this time and for a long time as they look ahead. We give thanks for the word that Sara brought to us. We hold up the image of Lydia and her beautiful purple cloth, which made her rich, and her generosity in opening her house to Paul and his disciples. And with Lydia in mind, we also commit ourselves to offering hospitality in creative ways during this time. We give thanks for each person who is part of this worship service today, and we remember those who are not present, and pray that they are well, and pray that they are connecting in ways that work for them. And we finally give thanks for the beauty of our world. Though it be filled with an invisible virus, it's awesomely beautiful, and we are so glad to have that in this time, and the way that that encourages us and sustains us and gives us a sense of wholeness and peace. So we lift this all up, this rambling prayer for rambling people. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You're perfect. Thank you. Y'all, we're doing communion. If you missed that memo, it's totally valid. Live your truth. But I would encourage you during this time to go scamper about and find yourself some juice or some water or coffee. You know, God's grace is not limited to grape juice. So, and I also to find a piece of bread or a cracker or a muffin or a bagel. All of those things are valid. So even though Jesus probably never had a blueberry muffin, which is really sad for Jesus, but you know, banana bread works, cake, live your truth. I don't care. I mean, I care, but like, you know, free in Christ. So if you are finding that valid, if you're not, great, read along with me. I'll be reading the italics, and you, church, are invited to respond with the bold, and then I will walk you through this communion, and this is our first time doing it, so we'll see. It'll be great. All right. Please respond with the bold, church. We cry out to you, Lord, come to us quickly. Listen to
our voice when we cry out to you.
Let our prayers come to you like incense. Let our uplifted hands
be like an offering.
Our eyes are on you, God.
We take refuge in you.
Loving and gracious God, from nothing you set into motion an unhurried sequence of events. They are astounding, life-giving, and grace-inducing. Each a moment that has led us to now, each a step on our journey. and you made this people made in your image. And thankfully, you remain with us just as unhurried, just as patient, and just as present every step along the way. You rescue and remain with each of us time and again from the rush and the anxiety of our own making, ensuring that we are never alone. So we join our voices with all those of heaven, joining their unending song, saying, Santo,
Santo, Santo, Santo, mi corazón te adora.
Mi corazón
te sabe decir, Santo eres Dios.
Loving, sacred, and wonderful one, truly you are holy, and you love us each so much that you sent your child, Jesus, to be in the midst. Be in the midst of your creation, in the midst of its turmoil and its trials and its joys. In the midst of uncertainty, you, Christ, took time, created community boldly and bravely. You created community, calling each of your children by name to be healed, renewed, and transformed. On the night of Christ's arrest and execution, he took more time to be present with those that are loved and called and each known by their name. Jesus knew that they were scared. Jesus knew that some were anxious and tired. Some were depressed, some would run and try to hide. But he took the time anyway. And then he took bread. And he blessed it. He broke it and he shared it with those friends. And he said, take, eat, and remember me. When the meal was over, Jesus took a cup and did the same, saying, as often as you drink of this, do it in remembrance of me. And because we, church, often can find ourselves scared, depressed, tired, ready to run, we remember Christ's example. We remember Christ's offering for us. And in so doing, we offer ourselves and proclaim the mystery of the faith that we live. Christ
you died, are risen, and will come again.
We await your kingdom come on earth.
Come on earth.
And your peace and justice. Glory. Now is the time for the epiclesis. So don't get started on the Jesus prayer just yet. We have a very important part still to do. We have not talked about epiclesis in so long, unless you were in the liturgy service time yesterday, and then we talked about it a lot. But maybe we forgot what epiclesis means. I would be sad, but don't worry, I'll still remind you. Epiclesis is simply a fancy church word that means the blessing of the communion elements. It is a reminder that just like that piece of bread or cracker or muffin broken, we are each a piece of the body of Christ. And like the body of Christ, we make up this one body. But each piece is so instrumental. Each piece goes out with hands and feet and heart of Christ to love and serve God. And in that, in your serving, you are a minister. You are ministering to other people. You are walking with them in their journey, and they are walking with you. So in that, every single person is a minister or a priest, making up the priesthood of all believers. So our practice at Old West is that every single person as fellow priests in the journey, is invited to bless the elements. It's not just me that blesses, but you. My table's over here, so I'm gonna have to turn. So I invite you to raise your hands, and you're gonna raise them over your own little table, your own little cute altar that you've made. It could be your dining room table, it could be a kitchen, it could be a stool in your office. But this is your communion table. So I invite you to raise your hands, and we're gonna bless our elements together. Holy, gracious, and life-giving God, because we long for your liberation and thirst for your justice, we pray, send your spirit. Send your unbound, unlimited, pervasive spirit to all of these gifts of bread and crackers, juice and water, that they may be for each of us in every home, your broken heart and your love outpoured for all of us and all the world. We pray that in sharing this meal together, We are nourished by your grace and hungry for your justice. So it is through love, with love, and in the imagination of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, God, our Creator, in the perfection of your grace, through faith in your child, Jesus Christ, our sibling and our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And it's in the spirit of our sibling Christ that we are bold to pray this prayer. Eternal Spirit,
Earth Maker,
Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all
that is and
that shall be, Divine Parent of all, Loving God,
God in heaven,
the hallowed of your name echoed through the universe. The way of justice followed by the peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings.
Your commonwealth of peace,
freedom, sustain our hope, come on earth. With the bread
we need for today,
feed us. In the hurt we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure,
spare us.
From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love,
now and forever.
Amen. So, church, I need you to grab your bread, your cracker, your muffin, whatever you're using. We learned in our liturgy workshop yesterday that one of the parts of the communion service is the fraction. That means the breaking of the bread. So hold your bread up if you can, or if you want to, you don't have to, free in Christ, you know. And we're going to break it together, and this symbolizes that we are the body of Christ given to the world, and we are all important. So break your bread. I'm so impressed with all of you. I feel like probably one of the only ones of you almost started breaking it into little pieces, but that's not helpful because it's just me right now. But one of the only people that has done this regular with me is Maya. So maybe y'all haven't been practicing your fractions before, but fractions are important for those still learning math. Different fraction. thanks for laughing at me, everyone. Church, this is your own table, and therefore you should know that you are fully welcome at it. But as is the body of Christ, and as the body of Christ, you are welcome to partake. So if you have communion and you want to take it, eat your bread, drink from your juice. This table is open to all. And if you have a friend with you or a family member, I invite you to share it with each other. And it's still awkward when I'm having to talk with my mouth full. So good things to know that some things never change in the church. And those are the things we're still having to deal with. Church, truly you are the body. So while your little bite might have been small, know that your part in the body of Christ is not. To lead us, to wrap us up for our service, we will sing one final song. They'll know we are Christians by our love. Who is leading that?
Me.
Yay!
Madonna.
If you are not leading, I invite you to mute yourself so that we can fully hear one another.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord, and we pray that our unity may one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. and we'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, thou know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard human dignity and save human pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Amazing. Thank you so much, LaDonna. Church, our benediction. I will lead it because I totally forgot to ask someone to do so. So just as a reminder, after the last Alleluias, John has taught us, and Montez has encouraged this practice so well, but we will say a regular Alleluia for ourselves, for our own hearts. We will say Alleluia for those around us, and then we will say Alleluia for the world. So and join me with the bold. God brings us together.
Together in faith, together in hope, together in love.
We have gathered together to be sent out again.
Sent out with the welcome message of God's love.
We go forth to be living testimonies of Christ's love.
May the peace of the risen Christ be with you.
Hallelujah!
Yay! Zoom church!
Church, we'll leave the link open a little bit longer. I'm gonna stop recording really quickly so that, you know, your personal life is not shared on the internet. Just a second, and you'll be good.